Man, so 4 years ago, at 2:30 in the morning, I woke up with excruciating pain in my chest and in my back. It felt like someone was taking a blowtorch from both sides and just like trying to get them to meet in the middle. Based on what happened earlier in the day, I had a feeling that I knew what it was. So I kind of shook Melody and woke her up and grabbed my phone and called 911. I asked them not to play the sirens because I didn't want them to wake my kids up. And I went to the medicine cabinet, I grabbed an aspirin, I chewed it up, and I went and I sat on the couch. I was feeling real clammy and close to passing out, faint, just in tremendous pain. Melody came and she sat next to me, and we just had kind of a really emotional conversation. Weren't sure exactly what this was, but we thought we knew, and that was scary. Paramedics came, and I went to the hospital, and it was funny. When I got there, everybody was kind of real chill. I think they saw a young guy, younger guy, and thought, well, maybe he just has indigestion, right? And the nurse, it was funny, she was sitting next to me, and she said, now, where do you want your IV? Do you want it in your hand? Do you want it in your arm? And as she said that, a doctor came in, and he was my age, but he was like, white as a ghost, man, so pale. He looked like worried, so that I got a little worried. And he said, what you don't want to hear a doctor say, this isn't good, Mr. Workman, you're having a heart attack. The nurse that was next to me, who was asking me before, where do you want these IVs, she just started putting IVs everywhere. You know, I'm getting plugged in everywhere. And this was a hospital where they could monitor a heart attack, but they couldn't do anything about it. So they wanted to fly me and medevac to Hershey Medical Center. So we still lived in Pennsylvania at this time. But the weather was too bad, so they needed to drive me about 30 minutes to another hospital. I had passed out once before and was starting to feel like I was going to pass out again. But this time it was different. Like, I can only describe this as I felt like life was leaving my body. It was the strangest thing in the world. Almost like I was getting lighter. Can't really describe it other than I thought for sure I was going to die. And that thought was going through my mind, and I had enough sense to tell the nurse, I'm getting ready to pass out again. And she started to put the head of the bed backward. And as she did that, two thoughts like simultaneously went through my mind, like in microseconds this happened. And my first thought was, I never got to say goodbye to my kids. And the second thought I had was, who's going to take care of my family? And man, in that moment, as soon as I thought those thoughts, there was a voice that if it had been audible, it wouldn't have been any more clear to me. And I heard this voice say to my heart, to my mind, in my ears, I don't know, I'm going to take care of them. And it was unbelievable. And a peace came over me, and I was laying back, and I looked up, and I saw this light, and it was the light in the ceiling. All this time, we thought it was like something else. It's a fluorescent light in the hospital room. That's what I saw. And it was so crazy because I remember thinking to myself, this is how it ends for me. Like, I wondered at times, you know, but this is it. Looking up, it's stinking like ceiling tiles in Hanover, Pennsylvania. This is how it's going to end for me. And the only thing really that was on my mind was people. It was my family. And I passed out. We're going to look at a chapter today in the Bible, in the book of John, chapter 17. The historical context, the setting of this passage is really important. Jesus prays a prayer in this passage. And when he prays this prayer is really important. It takes place after what we just celebrated. It takes place in the upper room. Jesus has washed his disciples' feet. They've shared a meal together and he's blessed it. All that we just went through. This prayer happens then. And what happens directly after Jesus prays this prayer? Don't miss this. The context really matters. After Jesus prays this prayer, he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane where he prays again. And then he's betrayed. And then he's arrested. And he goes through trials and he goes through beatings and he ultimately ends up on the cross to his crucifixion. Hours before Jesus dies, he prays this prayer. The things that we think about, the things that we talk about, the things that we pray about, hours before we die really matter. Those are the things that are the highest priority in our lives. We're not thinking about stuff and things we wish we would have done and going to see a new place or tried this, you know, this new job or this new venture. Man, the things that you're thinking about when it's your time to go are the things that absolutely matter most to you, that are the highest priority in your life. The things that you think about when you're about to die are the things that you value more than anything else. And they're not just head values, things that you say you value, they're foot values. They're things that really do matter to you. So we're gonna get a chance to get like a sneak peek into the prayer life of Jesus. And he's about to pray for something right before he dies. So what he's about to pray for must really matter to him. It must be like of utmost importance if he's praying about this right before he goes to the cross. When I thought I was about to die, my family was on my mind. They matter most to me. Let's look and see what matters most to Jesus. So John 17. Jesus says, I am praying not only for these disciples. So in verses 1 through 19, Jesus is praying a prayer. And then he kind of shifts perspectives when we get to verse 19. The focus shifts. He says, I'm not only praying for these disciples, but I'm praying for all who will ever believe in me through their message. Jesus is saying, I'm praying for each and every person in these seats at Sandals Church in Riverside, California. Back then, he was praying for you right now. At a real time, at a real place, Jesus prayed for you because we are here because of the disciples' message being carried out through the centuries, the message of the gospel. So it's hours before his death, and you're on his mind. Jesus prays for you. You should feel special because of that. So what he's about to pray must be really important to him. And here's what Jesus prays. He says, I pray that they will all, every one of them will be one. Circle whenever you see that word one. Just as you and I are one. As you are in me, Father, I am in you. And may they be in us so that the world will believe that you sent me. He says, I have given them the glory that you gave me, so they may be one as we are one. I am in them and you are in me. May they experience such perfect unity, mature, complete community, he's asking for, that the world will know that you sent me and that you love them as much as you love me. He's praying for the oneness, the unity of his body, the church. Positionally, in position, Jesus' prayer was answered the moment the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost in Acts and indwelled every believer for all time, uniting us together as one church. That has happened positionally. But practically, the actual outworking of oneness and living in community with one another is something that depends upon us. And Jesus is praying for this because he knows us. Listen, he knows that like the gravitational force and pull of our heart is toward individualism and isolation and faking it. He knows that our natural bent is that we stink at relationships. We make a mess of relationships all the time. So Jesus is praying that we would experience real community. Of all the things that he could be praying before he goes to the cross, he's praying that you and me will experience genuine, authentic, real community with one another. That's how close to the heart of God community is. Connectedness. Relationships within the body of Christ. So he shifts his focus from himself. But listen, I would have been praying for myself. I'm about to die on the cross. Think about all the things he was about to endure, and he takes time to pray for you and me that we would experience community and oneness. That's how much this matters to Jesus. I'm convinced if you had a chance to like sit face to face with Jesus, even just for a few minutes, like to lock eyes with him, maybe at, you know, coffee at Starbucks, and you're just sitting there and you get a chance and you said, Jesus, like, what matters most? Like, what should I be focusing on in my life? Beyond a shadow of a doubt, I'm convinced that Jesus would say, make community a priority in your life. I'm convinced of that because hours before his death, he's praying that you would experience it. If you're a small group leader here, you lead a community group at Sandals Church, and you ever wonder, like, is it worth it? I do all this preparation, and people bail at the last minute. Hey, I can't make it tonight. And you're discouraged, and you're frustrated. Maybe you're in a group, right, and you've kind of gotten some relational rubs that have rubbed you the wrong way, and things have gone sideways, and there's relational missteps. And you're like, is this really worth it? Is it worth the energy and the time and just all this stuff? Listen, according to this passage, it matters. It's worth it. Jesus prayed for it. If you're not in a group, right, you're not connected relationally through a group at Sandals, and you think to yourself, well, should I really rearrange my schedule and prioritize so that I could be a part of what he's talking about? Absolutely, the answer is yes, because Jesus prayed that you would do that. So why does it matter so much to Jesus? I mean, why is he praying that you and I would experience community? Why is it so important? Here it is. Here's the answer. It's simple. He doesn't want you to be alone. He doesn't want you to be alone. That's not his heart for you, that you would live the life of following Jesus alone. After I woke up from passing out, I was in the back of another ambulance. And it's something how looking through the back of an ambulance windows will really get your attention and help you focus on things in life. I was really cold, shivering, and I couldn't get warm. There was like a small blanket on me. I was in agonizing pain. They couldn't give me like any kind of medicine or anything because my heart rate was too low. My pulse was too low. Every time I took a breath in, just incredible piercing pain. I could hardly breathe. And I saw that my phone rang and it was Melody. So I picked up the phone and I talked to her maybe 30 seconds and I had to hand the phone to the paramedics. They just couldn't talk anymore. And he spoke to her and tried to comfort her. And he was a great guy. But when he put end on that call, when he hit end, there was something in me that just like went silent. I was alone. I was afraid. I didn't know how things were going to end up. And me, listen, like the king of introverts, there was something in me that craved community. I wanted someone who knew me in the back of that ambulance with me. Like, I needed that. I wanted that so bad. We get to the hospital, and they take me to the basement. It's even colder in the basement. And the doctor performs a procedure on me, a surgery that saved my life. He puts two stents in my heart and clears the blockage and it opens up. And the pain was like gone. I go up to my hospital room, you know, and I'm laying in bed and I'm alone. And it wasn't long before Melody walks in with three of our close, close friends. And I said like the stupidest thing in that moment. Sometimes I wonder, like, why am I an idiot? Why do I say things I don't even really mean? You know, do you ever do that? And I said, you guys didn't have to come. Like, you guys should. Like, what a stupid thing to say. How inauthentic, you know? And my friend Jason goes, Adam, if we don't come after you have a heart attack, when do we come? Like, when do we come then? Which made me laugh, and it was the first laugh I had in a while. And my friend Joe walked up to me and stood right beside me at my bedside. And he reached out and took my hand. And he said, nothing. He just cried. Two grown men in a hospital room holding hands, crying. And that community, some of the deepest community I've ever experienced. I've said this before, man, and I'll keep on saying it. If you don't have community in the good times, if you don't have community when everything's going great for you, when life is at its best, guess what you don't have in the worst of times? If you don't have community in the good times, you don't have community in the bad times when you need it most. You need community, and you need to be somebody's community. You need to be community for somebody else. Whenever we're not connected relationally, we are robbing people from the community that we would provide to them. The relational connectedness that we would provide. Listen, whether it's the back of an ambulance or you're in a crowded room, nobody wants to feel alone. I mean, sometimes we want to be alone, you know, especially if you have kids or needy friendships or something. But we don't want to be, like, lonely. Like, when we want to get away for a period of time, we want to be able to get away from people. We don't just want to be isolated and completely alone. I love what Pastor Matt said a few weeks ago. He said, you will never be who you were meant to be on your own because you were never meant to be alone. It's not how God designed the Christian life to be lived out and to be worked. Studies say that 1 out of 5 Americans suffer from persistent loneliness, 1 out of 5. And that social isolation increases a person's chance of premature death by 14%. Man, loneliness is killing us. You can be in a room filled with people just like this, or you can have lots of friends, and you can still be alone. Jesus wants you and I to experience real community. So what is real community? Man, real community is not just another set of relationships. It's not. It's intentional. I went to a church in my late teens, early 20s, and it's the kind of church that had like rows, those pew rows. And for 6 years, probably about 6 years, I sat behind like the same family for 6 years. They were in the row in front of me. And there's like only two things I can tell you about this family after 6 years. One thing is that they had a lot of kids. The other thing is that the dad, the guy, anytime he stood up, no, I'm not lying. Anytime he stood up, man, he would take his hands and he would put his hands in the back of his pants. I'm not talking about like in his pockets or like through his belt. My man had butt hands. Literally, he would take his hands and just put his hands like on his butt in his pants. Don't do that. If you're in here and you're doing that, dude, take the hands out. Do one of these, you know? So when the time came for like handshake time, I got real busy. I'm like, oh, what's something to, oh, this is over here. I don't think I shook the guy's hand one time in 6 years because he had butt hands. 6 years, that's all I could tell you about the people that sat in the row in front of me. Nobody's building intentional relationships in rows. Intentional relationships require circles. They require face-to-face, life on life. That's how you build intentional relationships. That's why we value small groups so much here at Sandals. Not because it's like some ministry fad that's real cool and everybody's doing it. It's what Jesus did. Jesus prays this, I pray that they will all be one, just as you and I are one. I have given them the glory you gave me so they may be one as we are one. Listen, Jesus is not praying like that we would just all get along and make nice with each other. That when we come here on the weekend, we would just shake hands and say, how you doing? Hey, I'm doing good. Jesus isn't praying hours before his death that you would just like have some more buddies to talk sports about with or something like that. Casual, superficial, surface relationships. That's not what Jesus is praying for hours before his death. And I just like, if that's the extent of your connection, I just want you to think about and consider. If that's the extent of your connectedness with other believers, why is that enough for you? Consider that. When Jesus prayed that you would experience so much more than that, he's praying that we would experience a depth of relationship with him and with others in a way that we never would even dream was possible. That's Jesus's prayer. He says in John 15, this is my commandment, he's saying, okay? This is my commandment. This isn't my suggestion to you. This isn't something that if you think about it, do it. If you have room in your schedule to fit it in. No, he's saying, for the followers of Jesus, this is my commandment to you, that you love each other in the same way, in the same way, in the same way that I have loved you. Jesus says, love each other the way that I loved you. The same way that I love you, you should love each other. You can't do that at a distance when someone's far away and you're not connected with them. And how does Jesus love us? Man, listen, he sacrificed for us. He has forgiven us. He has given us grace and mercy and showed us patience and kindness and goodness. And he has walked with us through the crap of our lives day in and day out. He has loved you in the middle of your mess and your brokenness. And if you tried to clean your life up and tried to get real good and better and presentable for Jesus, listen, it wouldn't change his love for you one degree. He loves you as much as he can love you. There is no more love for him to give. That's the kind of love he has for you. And Jesus is saying, love each other that way. Like, no kidding, love one another. In the middle of your mess, in the middle of your brokenness, in the middle of your mistakes, in the middle of your victories and your celebrations and everything, in the middle of your heartache and heartbreak and death and life, love each other. Love each other the way that I have loved you. That's the command of Jesus. I love, my wife said, just this past week, she said, it's not the fear of being known that keeps people from living in community. It's the fear of being known and still being loved that keeps people from living in community. Because what happens when I show up in group and I say, this is my junk this week. I was mean to my wife. I ignored my kids. I had a really tough week. Like, what if? That's always the question. What if I bare my soul to you? Will you still love me? What happens when I blow it and I mess up and I offend you, or I hurt your feelings, you hurt my feelings? Will we still love each other? Is the power of the cross and the blood of Jesus enough to overcome our mistakes in our relationship? Will you still love when you're known and when you know others? Real community is intentional. But it's not just that. Real community is not a place where we stay the same. It's transformational. Real community that Jesus prayed for is transformational. We need real community so we can experience real transformation. Listen to what Jesus prayed in verse 17. He said, make them holy by your truth. Change them. Transform them by your truth. Teach them your word, which is truth. Jesus expects, like, he expects that we would change. That's his expectation. And the more that, like, we read his word, and the more that we look at the way he lived his life and the things that he talked about, it should change the way that we think about community. Like, it should influence us, and it should transform us. When someone looks at your life, would they say that the influence of Jesus in your life has changed you? You may not know this about me, but I am like a diehard Philadelphia Eagles fan. And I die hard with the Eagles every year, man, because the Eagles die hard every year. Every year, this stinking team kills me. When my son was born, like, it was a Saturday. Sunday, the Eagles were on. So he and I watched our first Eagles game together in the hospital. Because I figured, part of my role as a dad is to teach my kids to love Jesus and to teach them to love Philadelphia Eagles football. That's the deal. And he's grown up to be a huge Eagles fan. Elijah has. He loves the team. But sometimes he'll say, "Dad, can I cheer for another team? Like when they're out of the playoffs or something, can I just cheer for another team? Can I pick another team?" And I say, "Yeah, man, you can pick another team. And you pick another family too." Like, I'm not really kidding. There's no way you're walking around my house cheering for the Giants or anybody else, man. You can do it in your heart. If you want to hide it in your heart and you want to sit there like with a mouth closed and just cheer for that other team, you can do it. Just don't let me find out about it, man, because someone else is going to have to feed you and clothe you and all kinds of stuff. It's not happening in my house. This is Eagles country. So when my son came home from Ethiopia that we adopted, Mehdi, he didn't know about like American football. He just knew that, you know, football was soccer. So September rolls around and he got to meet someone new, and that new person was football daddy. Because daddy gets a little intense and stuff when he watches the game. And I think the first few weeks where he was watching the games with us, he was watching me more than watching, you know, the team. But over the course of a season, that changed, and Mehdi was transformed into an Eagles fan. And just so you can see, listen, that's the typical posture of an Eagles fan. That's how we look all the time. Hands on our head, maybe we're throwing stuff. Mehdi was transformed because of my influence in his life. He has become an Eagles fan because of the love that his dad has for the Eagles. My daughter, Addison, will watch the first 5 minutes and then she's off singing and drawing somewhere. So Melody has to do some work with her. But Mehdi, he's been influenced. And because of my influence, he's been transformed. Because of my influence. Jesus is saying, and I think he would say this to you, if you hang around me and you hang around my people and you spend time with me, you will begin to realize that community is a really, really big deal to me. It's close to my heart and you'll be changed by it. I think Jesus would say that to you. Someone who was changed by Jesus, by the influence of Jesus and transformed, was a guy named Paul. His name even changed. He used to be Saul and his name became Paul. And he wrote this. He said, "Flee youthful passions." Say no to yourself is what he's saying. "And pursue righteousness, faith, love, and peace." Pursue transformation along with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. Along with those, the along with those is your community. It's people. He's not saying do it by yourself. Try to figure out and navigate this journey of following me all by yourself. He's saying do it in the context of relationships. Do it with others. That's how transformation is meant to work. He goes on in Ephesians and he writes this. He says, "We," community, in verse 15, "we will speak the truth in love." We will be real with one another. We will be real. We will speak the truth in love. "And as a result, we'll be growing in every way more and more like Christ." As we come face to face with each other and we're real with one another, and Jesus is the center of all we do, and his word is paramount, we will begin to change. we will become more and more like Jesus. Listen, being real isn't just about being honest. It's about being transformed. You can be real. You can be as real as you want, and you can be real content to stay the same. It's not just about being honest. God wants to use your realness to change you. Being real is the first step of transformation. Now, here's the deal. God accepts us exactly where we are. Like, He loves you, as I said before, just the way you are. You don't have to change a thing. He loves you. His love is always toward you at all times, and there's nothing you could ever do to change His love for you or make Him stop loving you. He loves you just the way you are. But at the same time, guys, God doesn't want to leave you where you are. He says this, I love you where you are. I love you here, but let me lead you there. Because there is better than here. And if you let me work in your life, and you let me operate the way I want to operate in your life, over there will be better and you'll see it. You will come alive in ways you never thought you would come alive as Jesus transforms you. Do you want that? Because it requires community according to Jesus. Relationships, real community is intentional and it's transformational. And we leverage a growing walk with God and a growing walk with others to reach out and make a difference in the world around us, because real community is not just meant for ourselves, it's missional. It's missional, like it has a purpose behind it. Being missional means there comes a point in which we turn our chairs from facing inward with each other, and instead of saying, hey, we've got ours, right? I mean, we've got our group and our community. Everyone else can figure it out on their own. No, we say we're going to turn our chairs outward and see how we can leverage community and use it as a catalyst to reach the world around us with the love of Jesus. The better we get, the more effective we are at living in community, in deep relationships with one another, the more effective we are at reaching out to the world around us. Listen to what Jesus says. I pray that they will be one just as you and I are one. And then He says this, so that the world will believe that you sent me. He goes on and says, may they experience such perfect unity with one another that the world will know that you sent me. When we're living in community, we're living on mission. Real community does not exist for itself. It always, always, always reaches outward. In Mark 3, Jesus prays another prayer. And it says He prayed all night. And when He was finished, He chose 12 like ordinary ragamuffin guys to be with Him. And if they were going to be with Him, that means they were going to be in community by Jesus and be transformed. But if they were going to be with Him, all 12, they would be with each other. They would experience intentional relationships. And if the verse ended there, okay, He chose 12 to be with Him, but it doesn't end there. He says He chose 12 to be with Him so that, here's the reason, He could send them out to preach. And the message they were preaching was the gospel. It was the good news of Jesus. Listen, we do things at Sandals Church like start new campuses like we're doing at Moreno Valley. Not so that Sandals Church can be a great institution and Sandals Church can have a great name. We leverage the community of Sandals to reach out to the world around us so Jesus can have a great name, so He can be lifted high, so that we can reach people with the gospel for Jesus. If people matter to God, they should matter to us. Jesus makes a big deal out of people, so we should make a big deal out of people. They matter to Him. So we leverage this beautiful gift of community that was not our idea to reach the world around us. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing. I think one of the great things about being a dad is like getting to watch your children kind of step into scary places and see them thrive, you know? My son Elijah has been asking like to take jiu-jitsu lessons, which is martial arts, for like a long time. And finally, back in October, September, we signed him up at USKO for jiu-jitsu. And he has never done anything like that in his life, like never. And I remember I drove him that night, and he was extra quiet. We got into the parking lot, and I parked and shut off the car. I said, "How are you doing, man?" He said, "I'm nervous." He said, "But Dad, I really want to do this." So I gave him a little pep talk, and then I prayed with him. And then we walked in, and I think for him, like, every step must have felt like a mile. You know, you want to do it, but it's going to happen. And I was a part of it with him, but I kind of wanted to, like, also in a bird's eye view, just watch this moment and this event and see how would Elijah respond. And man, he walked in, and I'll never forget when he took his sandals off and he walked on the mat. Like, he was committed then. There's no turning back. He walked in. And now to watch him thrive and love it, to be a part of something that was like, he was nervous, he was afraid, it was the unknown. But now, man, he's just soaring and can't imagine life without it. He loves it. Every Tuesday night, he wants to be there. Maybe you're nervous about community. Maybe you're like, "I don't even know like what this is about or what this would be like." And you're like, "I don't even know if I could do it." I want you to know this, that God has the heart of a good father. A good father. And he's cheering you on. He's in your corner and he's cheering you on. And maybe you're not nervous. Maybe you're skeptical, right? I totally get that. Maybe you're not skeptical. Maybe you've tried this before and you're like, "Nah, it's not for me. It doesn't work. I was burned in relationships before." Yep, I've been there. Maybe you're not skeptical or you haven't tried it before. Or maybe you have, but you're in a season where it's like, I'm not going to make a priority for that. Like, I would have to change things in my life and schedule to actually engage in the relationships that Jesus prayed hours before his death that I would engage in. I'm not trying to guilt trip you. Well, maybe a little. Whatever your story is, guys, Jesus has the heart of a good friend, and he is standing in your corner and he's cheering you on and he's saying, "Engage. Like, this is the way I designed this to work." And we've made it simple. You may already have some relationships, some friendships, some family, man. Grab a box, sign up one little form, start a group. We help and support you along the way. Maybe you're like, "I'm too afraid. I don't want to do this." Okay. Tuesday nights right here for 7 weeks during our next series. We'll be having tables in here. People will be meeting in small groups in this room. There's an on-ramp in, and if it's not for you, there's an off-ramp out. Or if you say, "Nah, I'm ready," you can join an existing group. You can join a brand new group that's getting started. We've made it simple as we can so that you can plug into the relationships that Jesus prayed that you would. God's praying that you'll experience real community, and I'm praying that you'll say yes. Would you guys pray with me? Jesus, thank you for the beautiful gift of community. That wasn't our idea. It was yours for us. You model perfect community. You live in perfect community in the Trinity. What an example. And when you came to earth, Jesus, you ordered your life with just some ordinary guys, and you showed us as an example what community should look like. And I pray that we would engage. Help us overcome our fear, our priorities, whatever it is, so that we can journey this life, not by ourselves, but that we can journey following you in relationships with others. In Jesus' name, amen.